Summit webcast series on the European Council. The European Council as an opportunity for smaller member states to exert influence. The power of different members of the European Council is often attributed to the population size or the economic resources of a country. Moreover, the Franco-German couple is usually named as an important player. In other words, small member states are seen in an inferior position. Yet, why have so many small member states joined the EU during the last decade? This webcast examines the opportunities and constraints of small member states to exert influence in the European Council. Let's first have a look at decision-making rules. For most decisions, the formal decision-making body representing the member states in the European Union is a council and not the European Council. In order to improve its decision-making capacities, the council in most cases decides by a qualified majority. Thus, countries face the risk of being overruled. A possible scenario under the rule of qualified majority voting is, for example, that Eurozone countries can outvote non-Eurozone countries. In contrast, if we look at the European Council, we find a consensus decision-making rule, i.e. decisions can only be taken with the consent of every member of the European Council. As in the European Council, every country could veto any decision, Professor Wessels argues that the European Council provides the political leaders of smaller states with the opportunity to have their voices heard.
Professor Wessels, how would you describe the position of small member states in the European Council? Are they rather inferior to larger ones, or does the European Council open up opportunities to smaller states?
I think the basic point is really that the small member states are sitting at the table. I think that's very important for them, that they are not just taking decisions which are passed by the big countries or the big member states, but that they are really have the opportunity to speak out whenever they think it's important for them. At the same time, of course, at the table, there seems to be a clear hierarchy of more important and less important members. Let's say this is not due for all time and for all points and for all issues. So if there's an issue for smaller countries which are important, then they can speak out.
The importance of the European Council for small member states can also be seen in the discussion on the office of a permanent president of the European Council. With the Lisbon Treaty, the former rotating presidency of the European Council was replaced by a permanent president. The introduction of this office was first formally deliberated at the Convention on the Future of Europe. Professor Lenkerovna served as a representative and a government alternate of the Czech Republic at the convention. She gives insights on how the cleavage between small and large member states played a role at the convention.
Sarovna, from your experience also in the convention, how would you see the process that led up to the current arrangement with the permanent president in the European Council as leader of the meetings and for finding consensus among the member states?
In the convention, there were several proposals for permanent presidencies, that these were mostly small member states and candidate countries, because they are mostly small, who wanted to stay with the former arrangement. It means to have only rotating presidency, because they were eager to have their own presidency, because they saw that at that time their country was on spotlight, that it was on the stage, that the summits were held in the countries of presidency. Then it was also experience of Austria. We were told that Austrian citizens didn't really realize that they are a member state unless they had a presidency and they really experienced and felt, and also how important it was for the civil service of the country, because they really had to act like Europeans. And then It was mostly proposal from France and Germany and supported by Britain and bigger states or old member states. It was to have permanent presidency, and there was an argument that permanent presidency could help consistency and continuity of European Council presidency. What was also debated was the figure of permanent president, that what was mostly perceived at that time, that it must be, or he or she must be a strong figure, that this so-called ABC proposal was debated. It means that this could be figures such as Spanish Prime Minister Aznar, British Blair, or French President Chirac. It was debated, and sometimes smaller countries, they were feeling like not being so much involved, but they agreed that a new arrangement, it means permanent presidency, would be helpful for more effectivity of European Council.
A similar observation to that of Professor Rovner is given by Professor Wessels. He adds how the length of a term of office was shaped by the cleavage between small and large member states.
How did the cleavage between small and large member states influence the office of the permanent president and the creation of the office of the permanent president?
Yes, the impression is that, or the insights which we have so far, is that small member states were very worried about the president of the European Council, the permanent president of the European Council, because they were afraid that this person would just travel between London, Paris, and Brussels, and Berlin. So that at that moment, they were very careful not to give this person too much power. You see that in the treaty articles, and especially concerning the length of his mandate. He is only elected for 2.5 years, and might be then renewed, but renewed only once. So after five years, it's the end of his term, which is in difference to, for example, the term of the President of the Commission. The President of the Commission is elected for 5 years and can be renewed as often as the members of the European Parliament wanted. Let's say there are clear constraints for the President of the European Council, and that's due to the worries of small member states.
In contrast to Professor Wessels and Professor Rovner's view, Ivo's logic points to situations where small countries were sidelined by other member states.
From the perspective of Czech country as a middle-sized country, the European Council is a platform where the Czech Republic can directly present their interests, and at the same time at least feels that it cannot be easily ignored because of the consensus principle of decision making there. This, of course, is on the paper. In reality, the Czech Republic and the Czech politicians experience quite intensive learning experience from real work of the European Council, including the fact that the Czech Republic, as we are not in Eurozone, we are excluded from one format of European Council or from this smaller European Council, the Eurozone summits. And since we are not approaching Eurozone soon, we are going to be excluded from this platform for quite a long time. So for this reason also, we were supporting idea of a strong communication between the European Council and the Eurozone summits. And for instance, the timing of both events, that the Eurozone summits should take place only after European summits. So they cannot serve as a platform of pre-negotiation of agenda, which should be placed in European summits, not Eurozone summits. We also experience, for instance, during negotiation of the fiscal compact, that even if there is a consensus principle for some affairs, majority of affairs in European Council, such as decision to change treaties, if there is sufficient political will to overcome it, it is possible, as the Czech and British opposition to the fiscal compact was simply solved from the EU perspective by putting the new agenda in a separate treaty signed by all EU countries but Czech Republic and the UK.